Okay, you can do better than that. Good morning, Oakland Church.
Good morning.
Okay, very good, very good. We're going to ask you to stand. We're going to begin our time this morning with a couple of songs of Christmas, a little bit different arrangements, but I'm sure you'll catch on. And we just ask you to join with us and exalt the Lord in this first Sunday of Advent.
Oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lowly exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel, shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou wisdom from on high, who orders all things far and nigh, to us the path of knowledge show,
hearts of shepherds, you draw the hearts of kings, and even as a baby, you were changing everything. You called me to your kingdom before your lips could speak, and even as a baby, you were reaching out.
House of the Lord today?
Yes.
Amen. Father, we love you. We thank you. We bless you. We pray, Lord, that you would, I pray you touch every heart that's present, and I would pray you would touch every heart that's at home watching online today, Jesus. Lord, we would pray that you would mark us, that we would leave this place different. And we celebrate the arrival of your Son Christ today, Lord. And so, Lord, we love you and we bless you. It's in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Hey, I want you to take a seat real quick. I want to invite the Chris family to come on up here. They're going to do our Advent reading this morning. Yeah, can we welcome the Chris's? Yeah. Amen. Amen.
Morning.
Good morning.
Okay. As our days grow shorter and our nights longer, we who are a people of faith turn to symbols such as candles, evergreens, and wreaths to proclaim our belief in unquenchable light. In hopeful anticipation, we prepare for the coming of the reign of God.
Amen.
Let us pray before we read God's word. Dear God, we're thankful for your word. May it strengthen, encourage, and awaken us this day, our walks with you. Lord, help us build a hedge of protection for good eyes and good ears. We pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We're reading from Isaiah chapter 64, 1 through 9. Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake at your presence.
As fire kindles the brushwood, as fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, then that the nations may tremble at your presence. When you did awesome things, which we did not expect, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. For from days of old, they have not heard or perceived by ear, nor has the eye seen a God besides you, who acts in behalf of the one who waits for him. You meet him who rejoices in doing righteousness, who remembers you in your ways. Behold, you were angry, for we have sinned. We continued in them a long time. And shall we be saved? For all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy garment. And all of us wither like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name, who arouses himself to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the power of our iniquities. But now, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, and you are our potter. And all of us are the work of your hand. Do not be angry beyond measure, O Lord, nor remember iniquity forever. behold, look now, all of us are your people.
And we who are pregnant with anticipation feel hope rise up within us. And so we light this first candle and name it hope. Amen. Amen.
The Lord praise.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen. 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 I'm gonna go ahead and ask that you'd stand again, and we're just gonna continue with our worship this morning.
Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. As the Spirit was moving over the water. Spirit, come move over us. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. So come down, Spirit, when you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come down, Spirit, when you move, you make my heart pound. When you fill the room, you're here and I know you are moving. I'm here and I know you will fill me. Come rest on us, come rest on us.
they were together in the upper room in one accord. Which means they had no differing opinions. Now imagine 120 people with all the same opinion that they needed the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Acts 2:3, they're crying out. Acts 2:3 says, there appeared to them tongues as of cloven fire that came and rested on each one of them. And that fire was accompanied with a wind that blew through the room. And then you know the story, they came out of the upper room and 3,000 people said, are you all inebriated, right? And they said, no, it's only 9 in the morning, but this is that which Joel had prophesied. That in the last days, I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Not just a handful of people, but all flesh. That your sons and daughters, love that, sons and daughters, men and women, shall prophesy. That your old men will dream dreams and your young men shall see visions. So this song, it's more than a song that we're singing. This is a prayer for the Holy Spirit to come and to fill us, to rest upon us. And just like in Matthew chapter 3, the heavens were open, the Spirit came and descended upon Jesus as a dove, and it remained. What if the Holy Spirit could come and our devotional life didn't look like this? But what if God could come and it started to look like this? So we're going to go back into this. Especially, I hope we hit that fire and wind. Do it again. But if you're in a room and you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit, you say, I am tired of wrestling in my dysfunction. I am tired of repeating perpetual sin cycles. I am ready to be set free. I believe right now is your moment. So we're going to go back into this, and what you're going to do is you're going to come and pray. We're going to lay our hands upon you, and I'm going to believe by faith that the Holy Spirit's going to come and He's going to touch you afresh. Amen. So come if you're ready.
Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. Come rest on us. Fire and wind, come and do it again. Open up the gates, let heaven on in. Come rest on us. When you fill the room, you're hearing.
just want more. I just want more. More of you, God. More of you, God. I just want more. I just want more. More of you, God. More of you. I pour out all I have and lay down all I am, making room for you. Lord, I'm ready to open up my heart, to receive not in part, but the fullness of who you are. Lord, I'm ready. I just want more. I just want more. More of you, God. More of you, God. I just want more. I just want more. Of who you are, Lord, I'm ready. I just want more. I just want more. More of you, God. More of you, God. I just want more. I just want more. Just one touch from your robe steals the weakness from my bones. Oh, I need more of you.
That's our prayer. people, Lord, we are desperate, poor, and hungry for more of you. And I think the answer for the world around us is more of you among us, Lord. So I'm praying, Lord, that you would increase our appetites today for you. You said those that hunger and thirst for righteousness shall be filled. Lord, we are hungering and we are thirsting today. No one satisfies like you, Lord. No other fountain will do, Lord. You said in John, Lord, you said, if any among you is thirsty, let him come and drink. And then once we drink, out of our innermost being will flow rivers of living water. So again, Lord, I believe the answer for the world around us is a greater measure of you among us. So I pray, Lord, that you would give us ears to hear and eyes to see that which you are doing. I would pray, Lord, that if you've got to flip over any tables in our heart today, that you'd go ahead and flip over any tables. We just invite you in, Lord, and we say, come and have your way. It's in the precious and holy name of your Son we pray this morning. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Let's give them some praise, church. Amen. Bible. I'll get those later. I got excited. Amen. Amen. That was awesome. It's not fair to have to preach after that. It's not fair. We're going to do a few quick announcements, then we're going to receive our tithes and offering. Tonight after prayer room, we're going to have our first Sunday fellowship, where we are going to bring finger foods. Last month we brought desserts, and we decided we didn't want anyone to get a leave with extra diabetes, so we're going to bring finger foods. That was a terrible joke. So anyway, we have that tonight after prayer room. Encourage you to come. Hey, next Sunday, immediately following journey groups, we're going to have a chili and soup cook-off, okay? We encourage you to bring a crock pot full of soup or chili, and we're just going to have a fun time fellowshipping with one another afterwards. Is that good? Yeah. Amen. So, is anyone excited for chili, or y'all like, okay? Friday, December the 22nd, I'm just reading them, all right? Friday, December the 22nd, there is the Women's Cookie Fellowship that will be right down here in this room. That way we won't be interfering with Recovery Church, and Lord's moving in Recovery Church as well, so I'm thankful for that. Thankful. But so bring 3 dozen pre-wrapped cookies or candles and candies. I can't read. 20 people corrected me. That's awesome. Normally, you just wait till after the sermon. Amen. And then, December 29th through 30th. Next week, we'll have sign-up sheets here. But December 29th through 30th, that's a Friday to Saturday. We are going from noon to noon, and we are going to be doing 24 hours of worship and prayer. And so, and we will be doing 24 hours. So anyway, we have some people from around the district that are going to come and help as well and partner with us. But we're just going to spend 24 hours. Jesus said, my house will be a house of prayer for all nations. And so we're going to spend 24 hours. So you'll be able to come up at any time of the day over that 24-hour period, and there will be someone praying and worshiping, all right? So we encourage you to come. I feel like that's a really important thing that we're going to do before the end of the year. And then the last thing is this, is that there are Christmas invites available. I'm not sure where they are at, but we do have them. So see Cheryl Ford, all right, if you need some Christmas invites to invite your friends. We are expecting a great, great time in the presence of the Lord on a Christmas Eve morning and Christmas Eve night. Amen. All right, let's pray for our offering. Now, I want to say this, that I don't know if you realize this, but when you give, it doesn't just stay here in house. That there are actually, you are part of 29,000 other Church of the Nazarene congregations globally. Yeah, you can clap for that. That's kind of a neat thing. There are over 29,000 Church of the Nazarene congregations. With that, and I believe, I could be incorrect right here, but last time I checked, there were 180 some odd world areas where we were located at as well. Some of them we cannot even name because it's dangerous for Christians to be in those areas. And yet we have people that are working to spread the gospel. So when you give, it does not just come to pay the electric bill. When you give, it goes to help spread the gospel across the world. Okay, just want to say that because you're part of something much bigger than what God is doing right here. And what God is doing right here is pretty big in my opinion. Okay, so you can give four different ways. You can give four different ways by dropping it in Dropbox right out there. You can give online at oaklandnaz.org. You can text to give, or you can drop it in the mail and it will get here and it will be deposited. But I want to pray for the offering. I pray, Lord, that you bless the offering. I pray, Lord, that you bless the giver, and I pray that you bless the gift. I pray that both become very, very blessed, and it stretches further on both ends than humanly possible, Lord. We love you, and we bless you. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. I have my voice back this week, so I'm ready. The Lord's been good. The Lord has been good, and I am... it's been a really good week in the Lord, so I won't go there. I'm just going to start sharing. Isaiah chapter 9, starting with verse 6. We're going to camp out here for the next four Sunday mornings, and we're going to be working through the names of Christ here out of what Isaiah prophesied. Now, chapter 9, verse 6 says this: "For a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest upon his shoulders. His name will be called Wonderful Counselor." That's what we're going to talk about today. Wonderful Counselor. That was gross. I'm sorry. Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. And I love this. There will be no end to the increase of his government, or to the increase of his kingdom, and of his peace. There'll be no end to the increase of that. On the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness from then on and forevermore. And then right here, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. By the way, the zeal of the Lord of hosts means the passion of the Lord of the angel armies will accomplish this. And we get to just partner with him in seeing this come to fruition. All right? So let's get into this. Isaiah 9:6, it says that the government will rest upon his shoulders, or the kingdom will rest upon his shoulders. The government, the rule, the empire, the dominion, the kingdom of God will rest upon the shoulders of Christ Jesus. And shoulders is the place of burdens. And so the kingdom rests upon Christ. And it not only rests upon Christ, it is Christ, it rests upon Christ. And let me say this, that when we pray, your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In God's kingdom, the kingdom is where God rules. The kingdom is where God reigns. The kingdom is where he has dominion. The kingdom of heaven is whatever the Lord says and desires and wants. It happens. Amen. Jesus, I need your help. It happens. And it will not only come through Jesus, but it will be fulfilled by Christ Jesus. Or it'll be empowered by Christ Jesus. Which means this, that it's not empowered by us as human beings. Yeah. Actually, Psalm 126 and 7, two of my favorite psalms. If you read those together, I think it gives our job description and it gives the Lord's job description. Psalm 126 says that those who sow in tears will reap songs of joy. And then Psalm 127:1 says, unless the Lord builds the house, the laborers build in vain. Our job is to pray and intercede and obey what God says. And when we obey, the kingdom of heaven comes. And then we see people saved, healed, delivered, sanctified, and set free. Like, that's what our call is to do, folks. And so it's empowered by Christ Jesus. Which means we don't have to struggle with it. We don't have to strive for it. We said a few weeks ago, the only time it's legal to strive in the Bible is to enter into rest. Be violent about entering into rest. Not laziness, in the rest. There is a difference. Verse 7, and there will be no end to the increase of his government or his kingdom or of his peace. There will be no end to the increase. Increase is marbah in the Hebrew. It means there will be no end to the abundance of his kingdom. Which means Jesus preached about it. I mean, Jesus said the kingdom of heaven is like leaven, right? What's it do?
Come on. Amen.
So either it's getting worse out there, or the kingdom of heaven's doing this.
Come on.
Just saying. Yeah, it's bad out there, but let me tell you what, God's moving.
Amen.
God's moving. And he's not going to lose.
That's right.
Actually, he didn't lose, okay? And so why do we pray for revival? I believe it's God's will, right? It's not God's, it's God's will not for us just to have good church services. It's God's will to pour himself out among us to where it begins to affect the world around us, right? And so we want to see our city be blessed. We want to see our families be blessed. We want to see our state be blessed. We want to see, right? We want to see the kingdoms of this world become the kingdoms of our God and of Christ, right? We want the knowledge of the glory of the Lord to cover the earth as the waters cover the sea, right? There will be no end to the increase of his government or of his peace, is what Isaiah was prophesying about Christ Jesus. And so it means there will be no end to the abundance. And we know the verse, John 10:10, right? The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but I have come that they may have life and life abundantly.
Amen.
In his kingdom, there's an abundance of peace. In his kingdom, there's abundance of hope. In his kingdom, there's an abundance of joy. I've told this story. I've probably told it here. I've told this story all over the place. But I'm going to tell it because I feel like telling it. But we were pastoring somewhere. It wasn't here, but we were pastoring somewhere. And the way the sanctuary is laid out back there where our sound booth is, there was a row of chairs. That's where the ushers sat every week in and week out, no fail. And those guys sat like this every week. Now, they were ushers. Like, they looked like the meanest people in the church, just being honest. And so we're growing, and we have all these new people come in the church, and I'm like, and I say new, like had never, no church experience whatsoever. And so they're coming in, and like, they're wandering around. What do I do? Like, wandering around, and the ushers are faithful. They're there, but they're sitting like this. So I had a meeting. I'm like, this is getting a little out of hand. We need to do something about this. All the people just wandering around in the middle of service or wandering around before it starts. And I said, hey, y'all's ushers. And this is how I knew the meeting was going to go real good, right? Because the first usher, the head usher, said, I've been an usher longer than you've been alive, son. So I knew the meeting was going to go real good. And I said, that's very true. I said, could you describe to me what your job description is? And they do. And they said, well, we're supposed to help greet people. We're supposed to help get people in the right places. Like, they had that down. They knew what they're supposed to do. And I said, okay, well, great. And I said, I want to add one part. I want you to exhibit the joy of the Lord when you do it. And I'll never, right? Who wants to be greeted by this? Come to my church. Right? And I said, I want you to exhibit the joy of the Lord. I'll never, ever forget it till the day I die. I said, this is what he said when I said you need to exhibit the joy of the Lord. He said, I have the joy of the Lord, brother. And I said, well, your heart needs to tell your face. The kingdom of heaven, right? And I'm not talking about fake and happiness. But the kingdom of heaven consists of righteousness, peace, and joy. Yes. Like the joy of the Lord, Nehemiah, the joy of the Lord is what? My strength. Yes. So for us as people, the kingdom, when it comes, we ought to be joyful. We ought to be righteous, living a holy life. And we ought to be filled with peace. We're not freaking out about everything that's going on. Yes. Right? Some of you are like, he probably shouldn't have said that. This is being live streamed. I can assure you, they are not watching. They're not, I promise. My picture's not on their fridge. So how does the abundant increase of the kingdom come? How does revival come? How because that's what we want. Yes. Like we want what God is doing among us to spread. Yes. Like, how does that happen? I think it comes, this is really simplistic, but I think it comes by way of recognizing who Jesus is and who we are in relation to him, yes. Right? His name will be called Wonderful Counselor.
Amen.
I'll just stop right there. We'll go through the rest of it in the next few weeks. His name will be called Wonderful Counselor. Wonderful means astonishingly great. It means wondrous. It means marvelous, all right? And not only is he astonishing, not like astonishing, whoa, right? Not only is he astonishing, not only is he wondrous, not only is he marvelous, but it says that he's the Wonderful Counselor. Counselor, I love this. Counselor means advisor. It means giver of advice. Now, by the way, Jesus' advice is not optional. Like, if you don't follow it, you're going to be in trouble, right? But Jesus, so I put all these definitions together. Jesus is the astonishingly, I can't say that word. It's like my grandma when she says aluminum, right? Jesus is the astonishingly marvelous advisor who gives wondrous advice. Like, we need the counsel of the Lord. Why we pray so much? Because we want to hear what he has to say.
Right.
Because when he speaks, we're going to respond to what he speaks. Like we need to hear from him. He doesn't just give, by the way, he doesn't just give good advice.
That's right.
He gives the most life-changing advice, if you will. And advice is such a terrible word. But he gives the most life-changing direction, if you will. If you will only yield yourself to him. Thing about advice too, you have the choice to respond to it,
yeah.
Right? I've had people, lots of people give me advice and I've been like, yeah, no, I'm not doing that. But then others, I'm like, oh, that's actually really good, right? Like he gives us the option whether or not we can choose to follow him or not.
Yeah.
It's called free will. So we begin to not only see revival here on the earth by recognizing who he is, that he's the Wonderful Counselor, but then we actually begin to see revival here on the earth of the kingdom spread or increase, however we want to say it today, by actually allowing him to be our Wonderful Counselor. I believe that if we would do that, that we would see the kingdoms of this world become the kingdoms of our God and his Christ, right? I believe that we would see the kingdom abundantly increase. I believe that we wouldn't have enough seats for people. I believe that we'd see revival. I believe that we would see a moral reformation in this nation, right? I believe that we would start to see people begin to be blessed and prosper. I believe that we would start to see things pushed out of our cities, right? We would start to see the crime rates drop. We'd start to see clinics closed down or abortion clinics closed down. We would start to see more children adopted. We would start to see, right, pair those together, by the way. But we would start to see those things happen. We would start to see politicians tell the truth. We would start to see, right? We would start to see God move in a great way. We would see drugs and alcohol pushed out of our city. We would see gambling places start to close down, right? That prey on people's poverty. We would start to see God move in a significant way where people wouldn't just say, it's just a season. No, we could start to say, this is going from glory to glory. This wasn't just an injection in the arm to get me through what I'm going through, but this is something where he comes and he's resting upon us and now he's going to move through us. So it's important to listen to him. Psalm 16. I feel it. I'll bless the Lord who counseled me. This is David, Psalm 16:7. I'll bless the Lord who counseled me. Indeed, my mind instructs me in the night. I have set the Lord continually before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Amen. Therefore, my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will dwell securely. For you will not abandon my soul to Sheol or to hell. Nor will you allow your Holy One to undergo decay. You will make known to me the path of life. Amen. In your presence is the fullness of joy. And in your right hand are pleasures forever.
Amen. Thank you.
David says, I will bless the Lord who counseled me. Amen. Counseled, giver of advice, instruction. And I love this. David is writing to a God that counsels him at night. Like we read this and we don't really realize what we're reading. David isn't saying when the sun goes down. David's saying when I walk through hell, yeah, you counsel me.
Right.
When I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I'll fear no evil, right? Like David's saying in my darkest night and my hardest of hard times, you will not abandon me. You will not forsaken me. You will counsel me. I will hear your voice, right? John 10:27, my sheep hear my voice. If you're Jesus' sheep, congratulations. Your birthright is to hear the voice of the Lord in your life.
Hallelujah.
Now, it's not always Morgan Freeman's voice talking, right? I'm going to get to heaven someday and the Lord's voice may just sound just like that and that'd be amazing. No, I tell you, it's a feeling led. It's an impression. It's a compulsion. You get a thought in your head and I'm like, man, I know that was too good for what's normally happening up here. That's from you, Lord. David says that when I go through these hard times, I will not be shaken because the Lord will counsel me. He will continue to speak to me. Because David allows God to counsel David, David's faith will not be shaken. Beloved, if we would allow God to counsel us, not just when things are good, but when things are hard and difficult, when it feels like things are dark, if we would begin to allow the Lord to counsel us, I promise you, we will not be shaken.
Amen.
We'll say, we can say stuff like Joel, or not Joel, but Job. Though you slay me, still I'll praise you. Or we can say things like, man, it is crazy all around me, but my feet are planted on solid ground, right? The wind and the waves will not crash me over. They will not knock me over. They will not discourage me. They will not. The devil's not going to eat my lunch, right? He's not going to steal my lunch, but I am going to stand and I am going to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I'm going to continue to believe. I'm going to continue to pray. I'm going to continue to have hope. I'm going to continue to expect the best, right? I'm going to continue to say there will be no end to the increase of his government or of his peace.
Woo!
Like, that's what he's looking for, folks. And so what would it look like practically for God to begin to really counsel us? It would, again, we wouldn't be shaken. I believe we would not get discouraged, which discouraged means lack of courage. We'd have the faith to face our problems. We'd have the faith to look at a giant and say, I'm about to have an heir. By the way, story of David and Goliath, incredible story, right? I'm going to look at that giant and I'm going to say, who dares defy the armies of the living God, right? And David doesn't engage in the hand-to-hand combat with a giant. David instead sends an airstrike with a sling and a stone, which is a picture of prayer and intercession.
Yeah.
Boom. And then David goes, we got kids in here. This is cool Bible stuff today, right? And then David goes and chops off the enemy's head with the enemy's sword. We'd start to see the giants fall.
That's right. Come on.
And I believe it would empower us to see the increase of God's kingdom here on the earth.
Yes. Agreed.
It's like, I thought this was Advent or Christmas season. It is. It is. Let me tell you, I put part of this online, and I'll probably give a little bit away of Christmas Eve, but Jesus, we celebrate the birth of a baby who had not accomplished anything yet. We celebrate the arrival. This is before he ever turned water into wine. This is before that Matthew 3 encounter where the Holy Spirit had descended upon him. This is before he went to the cross. This is before he went into the grave. This is before he rose from the grave. This is before he ascended into heaven. And we celebrate that.
Amen.
That gives me great hope.
Yes.
You know why? Because his arrival is the announcement that things are about to change. So for us as a people, we celebrate things in its infancy.
Amen.
Because even though it's in its infancy, we know that if we steward it and take care of it, that thing in its infancy has the potential to change the world.
Amen. So good.
This week I was reminded of Facebook memories. I like Facebook. I hate Facebook. There you go. I do. But I can't remember how many years ago, but I shared it this week because it came up in my memories. But we were at River City, and I had snapped a picture. We had just had an altar call, and there were tears on the altar. And I snapped a picture of the tears. And I thought, Lord, let me never take the tears for granted. Let me celebrate those tears. It was in all likelihood, the people who had the tears, they were probably hot messes even after the tears. But I'm going to celebrate those tears because that's an announcement that things are beginning to shift in their life. I'm nowhere near my notes. David says this. He said, you make known to me, verse 11, Psalm 16, 11. He says, you make known to me the path of life, which means he discloses. He reveals. And it actually means that it's similar to what's kind of spoken out in Deuteronomy 29:29, which says that the secret things belong to the Lord, but the things revealed to sons belong to them and their sons forever. It's this picture of you make known. There are some things that will only be revealed if we're walking in relationship with him. It's how you can read this 100 times and you can read something 100 times, but on the 101st time, the Lord reveals something to your heart.
Amen.
You read it, but then something gets revealed. Does that make sense?
So good.
And so, but that only comes by way, of walking with him and beginning to know his heart and his character. And so he begins to, David says, you disclose these things to me. Because of the relationship that we have with him, he will disclose the path of life. What do I do? Right? I mean, what do I do with my life, Lord? What's the next step I take? And like, that's a great question to ask. One of my favorite things, and we're dealing with this now with a 19-year-old, right, is what do I want to be when I grow up? Some of us are 40, 50, 60, still not sure, right? Some are like, I'm not sure if I'm ever going to grow up. But I heard someone else say this, and I took it, and I edited it, and I made it mine. I'm just going to say this, but I tell my boy all the time, and I tell other young people this all the time. Like, they'll say, what am I called to do in particular? They'll say stuff like that. And I don't know if I'm called to go into ministry. I don't know if I'm called to be a teacher. I don't know if I'm called to be a housewife. I don't know if I'm called to be a postal worker. I don't know if I'm called to be a grocery clerk. I don't know if I'm called to work at a bank. I don't know if I'm called to go get an engineering degree. I don't know what I'm called to do. And this may sound totally unspiritual, but I think it's of the utmost spiritual importance. What's your heart want to do? Because let me tell you, I don't know what you're called to do vocationally, but I know what you're called to do. Yeah. You're called to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. And to love your neighbors, you love yourself. That's what you're called to, son. You're called, but dad, am I called to minister? Am I called to be a worshiper? Am I called to do that? Bub, you're called to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and all your strength. Do you feel that rising up in your heart, what you want to do? What you feel like, yeah, yes, I do. Okay, well, let's run with that. And you know what I think? I think the Lord's so good that he'll counsel you if you love him with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind and all your strength. I think he'll give you the desires of your heart, which really it's Ezekiel 36. He removes your heart of stone. He gives you his heart of flesh. And then when he gives you the desires of your heart, it's actually his desires because it's his heart in you now. It's a mouthful. But I think it's about loving him. I think it's about worshiping him, and I think it's about adoring him. And I'm not diminishing the call because I know that I'm called to preach the gospel till I die. I know that. But I know my first call is to his feet.
Amen.
All right. Let's move forward. Oh, actually, no. Psalm 1:1 says this, how blessed is a man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Which means, again, you can take advice from the Lord or you can take advice from the wicked. It's up to you. Right? Nor stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seat of scoffers. I love the progression, by the way. When you take bad advice from bad people, you end up, right? The Bible also says that good company corrupts bad character, or good character is corrupted by bad company. But if you walk in the counsel of the wicked or walk in the advice of people that don't know you or don't know God, then you're going to end up standing on the path of sinners, right? Which is a really broad path. And then you're going to end up making yourself comfortable. And not only are you going to live a life of sin, you're going to live a life of ridicule and a life of mocking and a life of speaking out death. But nor sit in the seat of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, right? How do I hear God's voice? Get in his word.
Amen.
Nine of you. All right. How do I get counsel of the Lord? Well, you pray, you read, you pray, you read, you pray, you read, you pray, you read, you pray, you read. And throw in some fasting in there as well. He will be like a tree firmly planted by streams of water, which yields fruit in its season. Its leaf does not wither, and whatever he does, he prospers. Like this is the call of God for his people, that he wants to counsel us, to lead us, to guide us and direct us. It sounds really weird to call him Lord, but not do anything he ever asks us to do. Over the years, we've been blessed to speak in and help disciple a lot of people, and I feel like my job as someone that disciples or mentors is to give them godly counsel. I'm going to tell them what the word says. And then I'm going to share from some of my own experiences. I'm just going to go from there. But how many understand you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make a horse drink? And we'll never, ever forget that we had this one person that we were had invested a lot of time into, and they say, I need your help. What do I do? And we'd tell them, and they'd go do the exact opposite. And they'd make a mess of things, and then they'd call and say, this is what happened. I'm like, well, why did you do what you did? Well, I just felt like I need, okay, anyway. All right, what do I do? I think this is what you just do, and this is what the Word says. And they go do what they want, and made a bigger mess, and a bigger mess, and a bigger mess, and a bigger mess. And at one point, we finally just had to say, man, we can't keep this, we can't keep doing this. Like, there comes a point in time where we have to decide we're going to listen to the voice of the Lord. Now, I'm not saying the voice of the Lord. I'm saying, because all we're doing is giving scripture to people. Come to me for biblical counseling, and we'll give you the Bible. Now, some people say, well, I don't know if I can live that type of life, just always obeying the Lord. Jesus modeled it for us. Jesus modeled it for us. Look at Matthew, or not Matthew, but John chapter 8. We are landing this. John 8, 28 says this. Jesus says, when you lift up the Son of Man, then you'll know that I am He, and I do nothing under my own initiative. But I speak the things that the Father taught me. Amen. He says, I do nothing under my own initiative. I only do what I first hear or see the Father saying or doing. I believe that, like, He's God and He's holy and He's other, but He lives inside of us. Let me say that again for the room. He's God, He's holy, He's other, but He lives inside of us. Which means you don't have to try to obey God. He lives inside of you and He empowers you to obey God. Right? Jesus lived His life only doing what the Father counseled Him to do. Right? The kingdom will come in abundance when we live our lives in a way that we only do what the Father is counseling us to do. All right. Like, well, I just still don't know. Okay, we'll do one more verse. 1 John 4:17. By this, love is perfected with us, so that we may have confidence in the day of judgment. By the way, isn't that a comforting thought? Like, one day we're all going to be judged, but we can have confidence.
Amen.
Because as He is in this world, so also are we in this world. As He is in this world, so also are we in this world. So how can we see the kingdom begin to expand, increase? How can we see revival spread across this land? Allow Him to speak to our hearts and we obey accordingly. I can't do that. Yes, you can. Jesus did it. He lives inside of us. And this right here, 1 John says that as He is, so are we. And I'm not saying you're Jesus. I'm saying Jesus lives inside of you. I'm saying that you have His heart, His character, and His nature. If you've surrendered your life to Him, if you've been sanctified and filled with the Holy Spirit, you have the ability to follow what He's asking you to do. You have the ability to obey what He's asking you to do.
Yes.
So, you know, for us as a people, I'll rephrase just something real quick, and then we're going to pray. But why do we pray so much as a church, or why do we place so much value on it? Because I know that if we don't hear from the voice of God, we may have good results, but it won't be the results that He wants us to have.
That's right.
And I'd rather have something that when someone looks at me and says, how in the world did that happen at Oakland Church of Nazarene? How in the world did that happen in Cedar Rapids, Iowa? And I can go, I don't know. It wasn't because of my gifting.
Right.
It's not because of my wife's gifting. It's not because of my skill set. It's not because of the worship team's gifting. It's not because of any of these things we got going on. If it was because of the Lord.
Amen.
Well, you guys did this. Yeah, I get it. But let me just, that crown you're trying to put on me, I'm just going to go ahead and cast that thing right back down and say, that's not mine. That does not belong to me. That belongs to the Lord. Like, that's what I'm asking the Lord to do. I'm asking the Lord to move in such a way that we cannot explain it.
That's right. Yes.
I want the things that eye has not seen and ear has not heard, nor has entered into the hearts of man, that the Lord has prepared in advance for those that love him. It's like, Lord, we have to have you, right? And so why do we pray so much? Because we have to hear his voice. The thing I've been challenged by lately is this. Michael, begin to pray that when people hear my voice, they obey my voice. Remember, years ago, we were in this apartment. We're in this apartment, and this is before I was somewhat handy. And we had permission to paint from our landlords, and we actually had permission to peel wallpaper off the wall. And what we found was this, is that there were like 11 layers of wallpaper.
Always.
I don't understand it. Just give me a plain wall with paint, right? But I remember telling my dad, we got permission to paint and peel the wallpaper, and my dad said, son, you better not do that. That's what he told me. You better not do that, because I think there's a lot under there, and I'm pretty convinced that when you peel that final layer off, you're going to peel the paper off the sheetrock. Louis told me, I said, no, you don't know what you're talking about, right? So we steamed that wallpaper, and we peeled it, and the first like two or three layers, it was like, I'm feeling pretty good about myself. I'm really wanting to call Dad and saying, this is going great. We got that last layer. We soaked that thing down and pulled that last layer off, and it took the paper off the sheetrock. So I had to give it a rough texture finish before we painted it. It ended up taking a lot more work than it ever should have if I would have just listened. Beloved, I think some of us have been spinning our wheels and running around circles, and things have been a lot harder than they probably should have been. If we would just begin to listen to what the Lord's speaking. So I'm going to have you stand, and we're going to pray this morning. How's that for a helicopter landing? But I'm going to pray for a grace that us as a people begin to hear the Lord speak to us and that we obey what he speaks. Amen? Amen. And what you're going to find is the more the Lord speaks to you, the more you're going to crave his voice. And the more you're going to crave hearing from him. Amen. So, Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus. And thank you for what you've done here today. Thank you for what you did during worship, touching some people. Thank you for what you did even in the Word. I'm going to interrupt the prayer real quick because I want to give someone a chance. Is someone coming in here today and you were a whole lot of pain and you realize that you're not in pain right now? Back was really hurting. Knees were hurting, but now you don't feel it. Is that anyone? Just put your hand up if that's you. Okay. All right. See me after service. But Lord, I thank you. I thank you for your goodness and kindness. I thank you for what you're doing here at Oakland. And Lord, we want to see the increase of your kingdom. We want to see the spreading of your gospel. And so I would pray that you would give us ears to hear to what you're speaking, and I pray that you would give us the courage to obey what you're speaking to us, Lord. And so, Lord, I love you, and I bless you. I would pray that we start to see revival spread, not only here, but in our city and the cities that's close to this city, God. That's what I'm asking for today, Lord. Help us not to get so busy during this Christmas season that we forget what we're even celebrating. Help us not to forget to celebrate the small things, because the small things are an announcement that something bigger is coming, Lord. And so, Lord, we love you and we thank you today. I would pray, Lord, that it's not hard for us to obey you. I would pray that it's not difficult for us to obey you. And I would pray it would actually be a joy for us to obey what you're speaking, Lord. And so, Lord, we love you and we bless you today. It's in Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Yeah, amen. God bless you. God bless you, church. You are dismissed.